Welcome to Health Professional Radio. I'm your host, Neil Howard. Thank you for joining us for another segment. This morning, we're going to be having a conversation with Dr. Laurie Keefer. She's a psychologist at Mount Sinai in New York. And we're also going to be speaking with Allyson. She's joining us as someone who's living with UC or ulcerative colitis. Welcome to the program, both Dr. Keefer and Allyson. Thank you both.
Yeah, thanks for having us.
Well, Dr. Keefer, a bit of your background, of course, I mentioned that you are a psychologist with Mount Sinai in New York.
Sure. So I'm a health psychologist. I specialize in patients living with chronic digestive disorders, particularly ulcerative colitis and Crohn's disease, focusing both on treating patients, talking to them about their emotional well-being, as well as doing research in this area.
About how many people are suffering with the type of digestive disorder that you specifically treat?
So in the United States, about 3 million people are estimated to have inflammatory bowel diseases, and about a half of that is ulcerative colitis, the other type being Crohn's disease. So, it's not a highly prevalent condition, mm-hmm. but I think what's really important about it is that it affects younger people, and it's lifelong and can really be debilitating and costly to the healthcare system.
Now, Allyson, you've been diagnosed with ulcerative colitis. When did that happen for you?
That diagnosis was in 2007, so it's been some years for me now. It's been a journey. It was definitely a sudden diagnosis and something that was pretty life-altering for me and had a lot of impact on my physical health, but also my emotional well-being. And those are two things that I've really spent a great deal of time learning how to deal with myself and then moving into kind of an advocacy role, hoping to share my story with others so that they know that, we're not alone. It can be a sometimes embarrassing or difficult to discuss disease. And there are other people out there with shared experiences for support.
Did you find out that you were the prime candidate? Or, doctor mentioned that younger people seem to be diagnosed. Were you in that category back in 2007, or were you atypical of the normal person that would have it?
I don't know that that was really discussed with us at the time. So that's where I think part of this UC narrative survey was really enlightening for me, is that I learned more about my disease course mm-hmm. through the UC narrative survey, because back in 2007, I didn't know some of these things at all, which is part of what I learned.
What type of an impact did it have on your life? I mean, were you were just going along everything normal, and then all of a sudden one day, or was it something gradual that led up to you seeking help?
It was fairly sudden for me, which I couldn't speak to whether that's a typical course or not. So it was something very sudden for me. So looking at some of the results from the UC narrative survey, they found a lot that emotional exhaustion was something that I'm not alone in. That emotional exhaustion I felt, along with this really debilitating physical illness, was really, really present for me. So I had a really big challenge of trying to manage this disease coming on very quickly and trying to manage my family relationships, my life, and my career, and feeling really isolated. And then really finding a way to share that with other people, because it can be a kind of an awkward or an embarrassing thing to talk about when you first are diagnosed. And finding a way to open up about that was the way that I found to finally get some support for myself. And even being embarrassed to not even open up to my physicians as well. So I might have talked about the physical symptoms, but not telling them, besides these physical symptoms, I am really exhausted, and you're not seeing how exhausted I am. So my journey really took a whole, I'd probably say a decade, to really understand how to advocate for myself and not settle for a diminished quality of life.
Dr. Keefer, as a health psychologist, are these feelings typical of someone who's suffering with IBD or UC? And why is it that there is an embarrassment about getting sick?
That's a great question. So, first of all, the symptoms of UC are bloody diarrhea, mm-hmm. urgency to rush to the bathroom, abdominal cramping, right? So just in their own nature, they're embarrassing and uncomfortable. And in the survey, where we actually surveyed 2,000 adults with UC around the world, 84% of them said that UC was mentally exhausting. And interestingly, that was true regardless of whether they were having those very symptoms of diarrhea, urgency, or cramping. And so I think that, you know, it really shows us that you cannot separate the brain and the gut. You can't separate the mind and the body. We really can't disentangle mental and emotional health. And to Allyson's point, you know, if 84% of patients agree that UC is mentally exhausting, but most do not talk about it with their healthcare provider for a variety of reasons. They're embarrassed to admit that they're not tough enough to handle it. They're saying that they're, you know, that they're surviving their condition, they're managing their symptoms, they're settling. We don't want our patients to survive. We want them to really thrive. And it's important that we figure out a way to get patients and healthcare providers talking about this in a very open, open way.
When you and Allyson talk about the reality of this condition, if you couple that with what's going on now, how do you manage, Allyson? Dr. Keefer, how mm-hmm. do you help your patients via telehealth, telemedicine, if that is something that you're doing mm-hmm. like so many others are? And, you know, how do you manage that with the fear of COVID-19?
Mm-hmm. Well, from the patient side, you know, I think obviously there's uncertainty for everyone, you know, not just those of us living with a chronic inflammatory bowel disease like UC. I think obviously some stress and anxiety is a normal part of kind of living in what we are these days. And I think just making sure that you are being mindful of that as a part of our emotional well-being and making sure that you're taking care to tend to those needs. So for me, it is keeping in touch with my healthcare providers, if it's through telehealth, which it is right now, and making sure I'm taking care of myself as a whole. So if I don't have symptoms with my UC, I might be anxious about it. So I need to make sure that I'm taking care of my emotional well-being. All of this can be unsettling to anyone today. And, you know, certainly UC patients are no exception.
Dr. Keefer, when it comes to compliance with a treatment plan, how does anxiety play out? There are other conditions where compliance with medications or treatments is sometimes a problem. Now with telehealth, with people not maybe having access, what are your thoughts on that?
That's a great question. I mean, I think that's one of our biggest concerns is that, you know, a patient's emotional health is going to impact their ability to get care. You know, are they too anxious to come in for their medications and their treatment? I will say, though, that, you know, many of our UC patients have been using telemedicine long before this happened because of the fact that they don't, you know, I'm in New York City, right? Yeah. Nobody wants to ride the train when they have bloody diarrhea.
Yeah. Yeah.
So we've been using telehealth in a lot of ways to maintain continuity of care so that people comply with their medical treatment and encouraging patients to come in when they have to. But I think part of that emotional conversation can happen over telehealth in ways that, you know, we don't expect. Doctors love being able to meet patients' family, meet their dogs and cats over the telemedicine. It's a great segue into emotional health that you don't always get in the office visit. So I guess I would say the silver lining of telemedicine during COVID-19 mm-hmm. has been that some of our patients have developed different relationships with their physical providers, physical health providers.
As we used to say in the military, if you stay ready, you don't have to get ready, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, so it seems like you all were
ready and resilient.
Poised for such a time as this with already having experience with telehealth and remote treatment. That is part of the silver lining. Where can our listeners get some more information online about this UC narrative and about UC in general, Doctor?
So I would recommend that they go to talkinguc.com, which they can learn a lot about how to talk about their disease with their healthcare providers, as well as the Crohn's and Colitis Foundation. You know, again, the UC narrative was a study that was conducted on behalf of Pfizer. And so I think there's a lot of really great information that we've been able to pull from both the survey and from existing resources.
And Allyson, as an advocate, do you have anything that you'd like to add as far as reaching out or maybe some links?
Dr. Keefer gave the resource, and I just would encourage people to, even though we are physically distancing, we are not socially distancing, so stay connected with your friends, your family, your support systems. That has been helpful to me. And again, if you don't know, make sure you reach out to your medical experts and find out how things impact you. So, and we really appreciate you having us on today. Thank you so much.
And I thank both of you, Dr. Laurie Keefer and Allyson, for joining us here on Health Professional Radio. Audio copies of this program are available at hpr.fm and healthprofessionalradio.com.au. You can also subscribe to the podcast on iTunes. Listen in, download at SoundCloud, and be sure and subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/healthprofessionalradio.